By the time the current undergraduates send their children to college, Earth's population will have increased to more than 8 billion people.
One or more of the world's major cities will have experienced a devastating earthquake or volcanic eruption.
Sea level rise will be threatening low-lying coastal cities and whole island nations.
Natural resources will be less available and more expensive.
And our climate will be warmer and characterized by more frequent extreme weather events.
How we choose to plan for and attempt to mitigate these challenges will have consequences for individuals, nations, and our global economic and cultural systems.
Science can help us figure out the steps we need to address these grand challenges. As we introduce you to the scientific process, we have three objectives. First, we want you to be able to explain the term science in your own words. Second, we want you to be able to tell the difference between data and interpretations. And finally, we want you to be able to summarize the process by which science is practiced.
Now take a moment and think about what the term science means to you.
We can define science in many ways, but we think of it as having three basic characteristics. It's a process of discovery that helps us learn more about our world. Scientists find it tremendously exciting to discover novel ideas and make new interpretations.
Once that information is known, it becomes data to be shared with others. Always keep in mind that there is still more information yet to be discovered.
And finally, science is a creative process. Discovery doesn't happen without people thinking up new questions and ways to investigate them. You might not realize it, but science can be just as creative as art, music, and other aspects of our culture.
The basic building blocks of scientific discoveries are data and interpretations. Here are some examples. We can use quantitative data to measure the characteristics of Earth, such as the composition of our atmosphere. The air that we breathe is composed of mainly oxygen and nitrogen, but has a small concentration of carbon dioxide. Data collected over the last 50 years shows that the concentration of carbon dioxide is steadily rising.
Some of these gases added to our atmosphere come from natural sources, such as volcanoes. During volcanic eruptions, we end up with products that allow us to use qualitative terms to describe them, such as dark or glassy or vesicular, that is, rocks that are filled with gas bubbles.
We can take these different types of data and make interpretations about what happened on Earth. For example, data from a study of submerged trees along the coast of Oregon and Washington was correlated with historical tsunami records from Japan to show that the trees died when a huge earthquake occurred in January 1700. Scientists use this and other data to assess risk from future earthquake hazards.
So let's think about a basic example of data and interpretations that you might be familiar with from a non-geology setting. What data is illustrated in this graph? The graph shows both attendance and course grade. Some students obviously did much better than others in this course. On the basis of this data, why do you think that is? One simple interpretation would be that the better your attendance, the higher your grade.
Now you try it with these geological examples. Compare and contrast these two images. What types of data could you collect to learn more about these features? We might consider quantitative data like the dimensions of the craters, or qualitative data such as the types of rocks that are present at each location.
So that's the data, but what about the interpretations? How did these things form? It turns out that the crater above was formed by volcanic processes, and the crater below was formed by an asteroid impact.
The process of doing science involves making observations, generating a testable hypothesis, and, on the basis of that hypothesis, making some predictions. If all that works out, then you will probably have a pretty good understanding of some aspect of the Earth system.
Now you try it with this short video activity. Watch the video and think about the questions that appear. Now, what about those questions? But why did that happen? What are two potential hypotheses to explain these observations?
First, we might assume that while both cubes were the same size, the plastic that made them up was made of different components.
An alternative hypothesis could be that there was no difference between the cubes, and that the difference was in the liquid in the bottle.
What experiment could you do to test which of these hypotheses was correct? What prediction would you make about what might happen during the experiment?
One simple experiment would be to take a green cube and drop it into bottle A to see what would happen. If the cube was more dense than the red cube, you would predict it would sink again. But if there was no difference in the density of the cubes, and the difference is in the liquids, the green cube would float.
And that is indeed what happened, as bottle A contains salt water and bottle B contains regular tap water. The cubes are slightly more dense than regular water, but less dense than the salt water. So they float in bottle A and sink in bottle B.
So there were some observations, a couple of hypotheses, and some predictions. All of these components come together in the scientific process. Today we had three principal learning objectives. How confident are you that you could complete these tasks?